Well, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's my pleasure to be here in Montreal today and address you on the consequences of climate change, especially in our vineyards. I would have preferred in French, because French is my second language. I studied in France for 3 years in Dijon and Montpellier, but I can manage with English, no problem. Well, Eric, I was listening to you, very interesting conversation. I'd like to say that in our company, in our family, we have an award we give to suppliers every year. And 2 years ago, it was your company, Hillebrand, that got the award because you managed to get our transportation through Europe much cheaper in terms of emissions. So thank you very much. You're doing a good job. And let me know when you have a sailing ship ready to go from Barcelona to Canada, okay? I'll take it, no matter the cost, even if it costs twice more, I'll manage, okay? I'll have to talk to the SAQ afterwards, no? But that will be interesting. Okay, well, see, I was not always, you know, that keen on climate change until 2008. Then with my wife, we went to a movie called An Inconvenient Truth by Al Gore. And I was shocked. I was shocked, really. Afterwards, I told to my wife, that's going to be a disaster for the vineyards because the vines are so sensitive to heat. If climate is changing, what are we going to do? It's going to be a big problem. So I started to read books about climate change. Actually, I read more than 50. Right now, I'm reading a very interesting book that I recommend to you by Jeremy Rifkin. It's called The Third Industrial Revolution, and it builds on this, in our problem of climate change. And of course, you know, we started in our, well, in our family council, they accepted that we invest in, you know, things to manage or to help with climate change. What we have done first was to invest in renewable energies. So we bought photovoltaic panels, PV, we bought biomass, we started to buy electric cars, and so forth. So that was the start. That was the start. I think, well, that's in Catalonia, the last years, 1.2 more degrees. And we hope we don't go over 1.5, which is the target that we have for the next decades. Well, I'm sure that this morning Carol made and explained you already the consequences of climate change, so I will go very quickly on that. This from my, from James Lovelock. You see on the, on this one here, that was during the last glaciation, 20,000 years ago. That's where you have a warm period, like we had, I don't know, 40 million years ago, and that was 20th century. Today, we will be, you know, a little closer to this, okay? Because of this degree of temperature more. Probably, you know, you were told also that we had, of course, we had warm periods in the past 500 million of years. Why 500? Because that's when, you know, the Cambric started. The Cambric here, 500 million of years ago. That's when, you know, vegetation started to be as we see today. We got quercetin to build, you know, big trees. We got animals, not anymore one cell, yeast or bacteria, but, you know, much wider. And we had several warm periods. You can see here to the right. This will be the middle, 15 degrees. And, of course, we got glaciations. I like to show that one because, you know, that was in the Paleocene to the Eocene, about 50 million of years ago, temperatures went up very much, 6 degrees. But it took 20,000 years. The big difference with today is that in only 200 years, we've managed to get more than 1 degree. So that's a lot. And of course, this can only be explained because we are now in the Anthropocene. So this heating is caused by the men, by us. We had in the past 2,000 years some warm periods, you can see here in Middle Ages. That was made possible, here it made possible for the beings to arrive in Greenland and also in Canada. And then we had the cold period in the 17th, 18th century called the Little Ice Age. All this is documented and we know that. Actually, later on I'll tell you a word on the Catalan vines we are recovering after Phylloxera, and that some of these vines, the theory is that they come from this period when it was warmer. Okay, well, all these changes in these warmer periods, cooler periods, can be very well explained technically, scientifically, by these Milankovitch cycles, the Yugoslavian engineer that in the 20th century discovered all these cycles. They have to do with the equinox of the Earth around the Sun, with the axis of the planet going a bit more one side to the other. All these explain these changes. Also, of course, the sun spots for periods of 10 years, we have warmer or cooler periods. Volcano eruptions, which is true. I still remember 1962, well, 61, we got Pinatubo in Filipinas having a huge volcanic eruption. Big, very big. And as a consequence, you know, this year, the grapes could not mature because we got all these aerosols from the volcano, you know, making like a cloud that prevented solar rayons to come into the earth. And that made that the harvest, you know, was getting, we got botrytis before the grapes were mature. So we didn't make Mas La Plana this year, I remember, 1962. Okay, it was not a good year. Well, meteors, of course, they are responsible for that. The deep ocean currents also are very important to keep the balance in the planet. Actually, one theory is that this Gulf Stream warm current that goes up to the Arctic gets cooler and then gets down again, down to the Antarctic. Well, one theory by Inatubo and Kramsel from Denmark, they say that maybe in the future it could be that this deep ocean current is stopped, because if the Arctic becomes lost totally the ice, you know, it could be changes for this deep current. El Niño also has some effect in the changes, but maybe the one that we are seeing these days is deforestation. Deforestation is terrible. You've seen this summer in the, and especially in Brazil, this, they're deforestating all the time, cutting trees. And why are they cutting trees most of the times? Well, my friends, just to plant a lot of vegetal products, like corn, like soya, that afterwards will be used to feed cattle. So maybe that's something, if you really like to do something against climate change. I hope there is not in the room any meat producer. I hope so. Is there anyone in the room? No? Okay, so I can continue. You should eat less red meat. That's responsible for 20% of the emissions in the planet today. And it keeps going because Asia also, they want to eat meat. And it's, well, I stopped eating meat a long time ago and it's, I'll eat chicken sometimes. Okay, there is a total parallel between what we see since 1880 within CO2 emission and temperatures. There is a strong parallel. So more CO2 we put in the troposphere, this part of the atmosphere where we live, and the increase of the temperatures. We are now up to 420, and it keeps going up. Probably, you know, maybe, I hope so, in some years we reach a maximum of emissions. But so far, it is not stopping. And the worst is that we are reaching a point that maybe, you know, these methane ice bubbles that we have in Alaska, not far away from here, are gonna pop out because of the ice will be melt. It's happening already a little bit. And this could increase a lot the greenhouse gases that we have today. Well, the way the warming is happening, it's quite simple if you want. The sun is sending to the earth radiation, solar radiation. These are small regions, like X regions, gamma regions, alpha regions. And these regions, when arriving to the planet, if they meet clouds, they can be reflected. If they meet the ice, they are also reflected again into the troposphere, into the atmosphere, okay, 80-90%. That's why it's so bad that the Arctic is melting. And we'll tell more about that in a moment. Of course, you know, if these regions meet the forest or the water, then the heat stays here. What happens then? This warmer from the Earth then tries to escape, but when escaping, it meets, this is not really clouds, but meets all these greenhouse gases, CO2, methane, and so forth. And this is like a greenhouse. You know the greenhouses in the countryside where they grow tomatoes or whatever. Okay, these greenhouse gases will reflect again these warm regions, and they will come again, and it will make like a circulation. That's the warming. It's that simple. And unless we get rid of these greenhouse gases, this will continue to increase. We had a wonderful model in the Earth until 200 years ago. We had a unique world in all the galaxies we know, because this heat from the planet was needed. Part of it was staying here. This made life possible for the last 20,000 years at least, or more, a million years. But then, when we got so many greenhouse gases, this changed totally. So we have destroyed a wonderful world, a wonderful balance that we had for so many millennia. Okay, well, talking about, this effect of the solar regions in the Earth, what happens today is that we are, especially in the north, and this is affecting your country, is that we are losing the albedo effect. Albedo effect is when the sun regions hit the ice and is reflected. This is called albedo effect, from the Greek albos, which means white, okay? And because of the loss of the Arctic in the last decades, you can see that in the last years, according to NASA, here in the north, you are getting much more warming than they have in the central part of Europe, okay? Or even this part, close to the Antarctic. So that's again, anthropogenic heat is because we are sending too many greenhouse gases. Well, ice is melting also in Greenland, and the ice in the planet, still 85% of it stays in the Antarctic. I was in Patagonia 10 days ago, and it's real cool there still. But the rest, Greenland is losing ice, and the glaciers also, as you know, they are becoming less, more and more weaker. What happens then with these CO2 emissions that we produce? Well, roughly we could say that 50% of them are still absorbed by continental and sea assimilation. In the continents is photosynthesis, and then the vines, they have an important role in that. The vine takes a lot of CO2 when growing and producing leaves and grapes and all these things. In the sea, you have the phytoplankton, which is the vegetals, like algae, seaweed, and you have also the phytoplankton, and you have the foraminifers, which is small, tiny animals. They have like a shell, and they can also absorb CO2, and when they die, they go deep into the ocean at the bottom, and they store, that's why the oceans store millions of gigatons of carbon. So phytoplankton and zooplankton in the seas are responsible also and helping to maintain a little balance. But unfortunately, all this goes to the atmosphere, goes to the troposphere where we live, and creates greenhouse gases. Okay, present day balance, consequence to the vineyards. Why are the vines so sensitive? Well, here are some proofs. The fires. In 2017, in Chile, in one of our vineyards, this is the vineyard of Empedrado, near the city of Constitución, we got the fire, not in the vineyard, but in the forest. But then, of course, the first rows of the vines were affected. You can see them here. burned by the fire. And the worst was that the valley was flooded with smoke from the fires. And then the wine afterwards got a very, very lousy taste. So we couldn't use it for our wines. That's, well, one consequence. Frost. Frost is becoming more and more frequent in our vineyards, in Catalonia or even in Chile. This was in Panades, near Barcelona, in 2017. Frost in the spring can create, of course, many, many problems in the vineyards. But we also got hail. I remember, you know, 20 years ago, 30 years ago, hail was strange. You heard of it, you know, once every 5 or 10 years. Now it's coming almost every 2 years, we got hail, especially in the mountain areas. Then we have to cover the vines with these nets, you see here, to protect from the hail. This is also something we are observing recently, that is the consequence of the heat. You see, it happens now in the summers when you have these very warm days, these waves of heat, right? And the temperatures can reach, you know, maybe only for only 1 or 2 days, they can reach 38, 39 degrees. Then the vines, if they don't have enough water underneath, or if they are not irrigated, which is often the case, then they get like this. They get burned by the heat. And of course you lose the harvest. This is only, you know, in small plots, if there is not enough clay in the soil to store the water. But it happens sometimes, you know, suddenly the soil is a bit more sandy, and then you have these consequences. Well, the next slide is very important. I hope you can see from your seats. First of all, this is from the IPCC, Intergovernmental Panel for Climate Change. Have a look first at emissions. These are the emissions. This is today, 100 years, 500 years, 1,000 years. And this is the magnitude of the response. So if you take the emissions, we can see that maybe, you know, by 2040, we're going to reach a maximum of emissions. Let's hope we can get it first, before that, because I think 2040 is much too late. But once we get the maximum of emissions, it doesn't mean we are ending the problem. Temperatures, which is the red one, will continue to increase until we reach stabilization after several hundred years. So it's long term. What happens with the sea level? Sea level because the melting of the ice continue to rise several millennia. Even the thermal expansion will also make the sea level to grow. So don't buy houses, my friend, near the sea. Don't buy houses anymore. It's going to be a big problem. Okay, we'll talk more about what we can do, try to change the things. Well, at Torres in the last decade, 12 years, we invested about 15 million euros, not all in renewable energies or research. Also, we had to buy land because we had to adapt. We could not, you know, suddenly tell our customers, I hope there are many in the room, that, well, listen, our wine maybe is not so good anymore because of climate change. We have to continue to produce top quality wines. And that's why then we have to buy land at higher altitude. In Spain, in the Pyrenees, maybe 1,000 meters. And in Chile, we go more to the south, even down to Itata Valley. We buy land, which is cooler climate, so we can continue to produce the quality we want. Okay, this is more or less what we have done. We have reduced so far 26, well, we are almost 28 now, and by next year, 2020, our emissions will be reduced by 30%. And the target is in 2030 to reach a reduction of 50%. Okay, what are we doing then in order to achieve that? Well, forest management, we have 1,500 hectares of forest in Spain, also in Chile, in Patagonia. We also have helped to plant forests in parts of Spain, in Catalonia, in Canary Islands. The forest is very important. Planting trees today is the most important thing you can do to resist, to mitigate the effects of climate change. That's very, very important. And so if you have the possibility to plant trees in your gardens, whatever, do it. I read recently that if we could have in the world planted 900 million of trees, we could stop the warming. It's only 900 million. Okay? And some countries are doing an effort. I know China is doing it, India are doing an effort, Pakistan, because they see the consequences of the warming. Okay, water is a problem also for viticulture. So we have to store the water. We are now building more and more basins like this in the vineyards to store the water from the winter, especially in the slopes, and then be able to irrigate in the summer. We are irrigating already about a third of our vineyards, and we plan to increase this slowly. Normally, we use drip irrigation in our vineyards. Drip irrigation will supply just the quantity the roots need when exploring the soil. You see, you have to have the water in the soil, then the water becomes like a drops. Right. The drops are around, and if the roots do not meet the water, at least maximum 40 centimeters, it is never absorbed. So we need to have drip irrigation to really have the water well spread. What can we do then in order to resist climate change and continue to produce quality wines? Well, we have to adapt the vineyards, which means, first of all, we have to delay ripening, maturation. See, I hate to see some areas in Spain are already harvesting late July, early August. That's terrible. You cannot have quality then. What can we do? We have to delay ripening. And that means, for example, in that case, changing rootstocks for the new planting. Some rootstocks, you know, what we plant first to resist phylloxera, some rootstocks can be delaying maturation. Also, for example, changing the, adapting the vineyards, changing the density. If you plant 5,000 vines to the hectare, right, you are advancing maturation because there is more competition among vines. If you're planting less, 2,500, then there is less competition and maturation is delayed. And that's what we want. We want to reach the month of September because then the nights are cooler still today, and then we can have quality elements. The sugar is there, of course. The sugar is there already in August, but we want anthocyanins. We want, you know, the color. We want the tannins. That's what makes the quality of the wine. Well, of course, we are not doing any more de-leafing. I'm sure you've seen in your life visiting vineyards in the month of July or so that the leaves were being removed, the basal leaf hiding the grapes. Today, we prefer to keep the leaves. We don't do this anymore because then we have a cooler microclimate. Yes, maybe we'll have a little bit more of botrytis in the weeks to come, but still it's better to have the shadow from the leaves. Other things we can do. Well, we can adapt our vineyards in order to delay ripening also. We've done experiments. We see that if the vines is draining, like now at 60 centimeters, or if we go a little higher, like 90 centimeters, then in that case, we are delaying maturation. See, because it's more difficult for the shape to go up, and it's a positive consequence. Also, for example, the leaf canopy. This, we've done this experiment for almost 8 years now. Instead of 1.2 meters of canopy, this is the canopy, the amount of leaves exposed to the sunlight and the winds. If we reduce this to 0.7, we are delaying maturation. It's very simple. The factory, which are the leaves exposed to the sunlight, are less. So they need more time to make the grapes to mature. There is also the other things we can do. We have this hail. The hail we use for to prevent the hail, the net to prevent the hail can also delay maturation. So this is another positive consequence that we are seeing. Also, gobelet training. See, the Greek viticulture started with gobelet. Still in Spain, most of the vineyards are in gobelet. They are not, you know, in the Guyot system. So gobelet training also delays maturation. And all these ideas, all these experiments, we have a collection, 5 hectares collection in one of our vineyards near the restaurant where we are. And it's very efficient because then we can see that putting, you know, many things together for the next decade when we plant vineyards, well, we have the possibility to reduce maturation. Right. Now, I have a question for you. Is the organic viticulture the answer for the future? I know many people buy organic products. Today I'm going to talk only about wine. Is that so healthy for the planet to buy organic wines? My friends, I'm afraid the answer is not sure, you know, that positive. Why? Why is that? First, organic vineyards can only be spread with copper for the mildew and sulfur for the powdery mildew. It happens that copper is toxic for the soil. And you see, organic people are very proud to say, we do like father, like grandfather. Yes, but still copper is toxic for the soils. And we're looking in Brussels, we're trying to reach in Europe an agreement to replace copper, but it's very difficult to get all the Europeans to agree on something. So this is one thing. But the other aspect is the emissions. Because of these products, bougie bordelaise or sulfur, only stay 1 week on the leaves, as opposed to the synthesis products that can penetrate a little bit. After a week, you have to repeat the treatments, and more and more. That means you are creating more emissions of CO2 to the atmosphere. So maybe in the future, we can have electric tractors. Yes, if we have electric tractors, then I would change my reasoning, but so far they are very expensive and there are very few of them. Okay, another aspect that we are considering also in this aspect of the warming and what we can do, we have been recovering since the 1980s Catalan varieties that disappeared when Phylloxera arrived in the Penedès in the second part of the 19th century. And all these vines, you know, we had more than 100, almost all of them disappeared because in the 20th century, what people wanted to have were grapes that could produce quantity of wine, because the wine was in demand all over Europe, so because of Phylloxera. So we started in 1982, the search in quest of the old Catalans. And why is that? Because a vine never dies. You can take out a vineyard today, Tempranillo, for example. You take it out, and you burn everything. I tell you, if you come 10 years after, there's going to be some Tempranillo left. Maybe at the border, maybe in the nearby forest, you're going to see a Tempranillo vine growing around. That's why, you know, it's been possible for us to get and to find a lot of these Catalans. Also, we run small ads in the Catalan newspapers in the summer, and we tell the farmers, if there is one vine in your vineyard that you don't know what it is, give us a call. And people call, I tell you. Most times it's not worth, but, you know, once every 20, maybe it is worth. So we recovered already more than 50 of these old Catalans, which means almost half of the pre-existing before Phylloxera. And here you have six of them. It's going to be a tasting table afterwards. We brought from Spain some of these wines for you to taste, if you are interested having a taste of from the 19th century or before from these grapes. And the interesting thing of these vines is that we see that some of them probably come from the warming period because they are keeping the acidity very well. You will taste a grape which is called Forcada. It's a white grape. And the acidity is so intense that we have to wait until October at least to harvest it. So that's very good for us because we're looking for that. We're looking for vines that can stand with the warming. Okay. Well, Time magazine already in 2011 came to visit us and already was the start, you know, of this growing interest for the warming in all the scales. Another solution in the future for viticulture could be to change of grape because you can see in this chart every vine needs a certain amount of heat. Here to the left, there are vines like Müller-Turgot or Pinot Gris, which they don't need much heat to mature. On the extreme, here below, you have grapes like Garnacha, Zinfandel, that need a lot of heat. So maybe in the future, you're going to see that in Burgundy, instead of Pinot Noir, they're going to have to plant Tempranillo. Okay? The wines, of course, are going to be different, but Tempranillo can resist much more the heat. Right. Well, this is what we are doing in adapting to the new climates. This is land we have today in the Pyrenees. In the Pyrenees, near the Pyrenees. It's to 1,200 meters, it's still too cold to plant, but probably in 10 years we're going to be planting vines in this state. And then there is Chile. This is Itata in the southern part of Chile, 230 hectares with a little cooler climate and a lot of water, because water is going to be also a limiting factor in Chilean viticulture in the next decades, because the Andes are supplying, you know, from the glaciers, the water to irrigate the Central Valley. But then, you know, as it goes on, these glaciers are becoming weaker and weaker. So maybe in 50 years' time, we don't have enough water to irrigate the vineyards in the summer. And remember, it doesn't rain in Chile or in California in the summertime normally. So we also bought land in Patagonia. What you see here is Patagonia. We bought a piece of land 2 years ago, 6,000 hectares. 6,000 hectares, that's big, my friends, it's big. And didn't cost much, actually. It costs like, you know, an apartment, luxury apartment in probably Montreal. But why do we go to Patagonia? Maybe some of you are thinking, but this man is mad. He's not going to plant vines in Patagonia. It's too cold for there. We are there to plant trees. We are planting trees. Why? Because this is going to compensate our emissions. When I told you we want to reach 50% reduction in 2030, we count on the forest that we are planting here. That's the way it looks today, you see? It's only this gramini there that only the lamb can eat. But 10 years from now, it's going to be a beautiful forest growing. In Spain, of course, we lose a lot of photovoltaic panels to produce our electricity. We have, for our tourists, they take this small train that works also on photovoltaic panels, and people love it, you know, the idea that there is no gasoline there, no petrol. This is my car. I drive an electric car, my son too. I have PVs in my house. I have photovoltaic panels and a small battery. So every night I plug and I get my car charged. And it's costing me nothing. Costing me nothing. Why is that not possible to be done here? It's amazing. I heard friends here in Montreal telling me, yes, but you know, Mr. Torres, electric cars are not possible in this part of Canada because it's too cold. I'm sure it is only a lie. I am sure. Because, you know, the car producers, they keep saying that all the time. This or other reasons. I'm sure that electric cars could function very well in Canada. I tell you, it's fantastic, the idea that you don't have to go anymore to gasoline stations and you stop carbonization of the planet. So just think of it. Eh? And I don't have a commission from the electric manufacturers. Eh? Don't take me wrong. Okay, this is bottling materials. You know that every wine producer has made an effort in the last years to reduce the weight of the glass. You can see today, our bottles are around 300 grams per bottle. Now, back in the box, that is used very much in Scandinavia for entry-level wines, is a possibility, but it doesn't look so nice. Of course, you are not having to present a back in the box at your table with your friends, no? PET, plastic, is another possibility. Well, we don't do it either. This is the future, my friends. A bottle that can be reused, reutilized, not recycled, no, in pieces, no. The whole bottle reutilized 6 times at least. We are talking to monopolies, like here, like in Scandinavia. We tell them, will you allow us in the future to bottle our entry-level wines, Sangre de Toro, here in Canada? We'll send the wine, we'll send a technician to make sure about the quality. And then this bottle can be recuperated, right, washed, and deliver again to the bottling line. This could save a lot of greenhouse gases, and people will continue to drink wine. It would be great. So that's maybe the future, reutilize the bottle. Of course, we need then the bottles to be standard, to have not for the top wines, you know, then everybody can make what he wants, but for at least 80% of the bottles in the market, we should have in Canada, in Europe, standard bottles. Well, If you like to know more about carbon emissions, this is what you have to do in any company to estimate, to calculate your emissions. This is called carbon footprint. Carbon footprint takes every aspect of your production. For example, the fuels used at the winery, that's scope 1. Electricity you buy, scope 2. Scope 3 to the left, That's everything you buy, from the grapes to the glass, which is very expensive, and the carton. And to the right, the delivery, Hillebrand knows that, to destination, okay? All together, this your carbon footprint. We are starting to have this in our labels next year, January next year, explaining to consumers how much we are reducing. And the problem is that, you know, some companies don't take care of scope 3. They just calculate 1 and 2. This should be all of it. Otherwise, it's not well done. Okay, our suppliers, well, in this case, these farmers, they are helping us also to reduce emissions. Our packaging suppliers, bottles, cartons, everybody every year tries to progress, tries to reduce emissions. And then we have the Torres and Earth Awards every year. Yeah, there were some of them, viticulture, carton manufacture, capsule, and so forth. Another aspect that we are considering, not for tomorrow, but for the next 5 years, is the recuperation of the CO2 that we emit at the fermentation. See, when the wine is fermenting, everybody knows that, CO2 goes up to the troposphere. You can say this CO2 was first absorbed by the vine at photosynthesis, right, when growing. So it's a natural CO2. In a way, if it's going out again, well, you are recovering the balance. But the dream is that if we can capture in the future, this CO2 will be helping to reduce the greenhouse gases. When I say we, I say all the wine people, because I think the wine people, we have a lot of things to do in that field. So what have we done so far? We have done tests with several companies, universities. The one that seems to be working more is the methanation, which is transforming CO2 into methane. And this methane becomes a biogas, and can be used for cars, can be used for machines, whatever. But there are, you know, other possibilities. We keep experimenting. And I hope before 5 years, we can at least take 10% of this gas. It's very expensive, but we are asking Brussels to help. We will see what happens. Right, this is methanization. Well, I don't think people are, well, in Canada, you have very small viticulture. I've been to your vineyards. They are beautiful in the north. Still there, the cold is a problem, the frost in the winter and in the spring. But in Europe, we have droughts, we have hail, late frost, we have fires. So it's really complicated, becoming complicated for the viticulture. Well, there is still hope. If we use more and more the sun energy, which is free, we don't have to pay anybody for the sun energy and for the wind energy. This is a little bit our little history. Well, we started in 2007 with our project. Then we had Paris Agreement, 2015. 2030, we're going to reach 50%, hopefully. 2025, in Europe, we get taxes for fossil fuels. This is very serious now becoming in Europe. I know in Canada, I heard Monsieur Pierre Trudeau today at the television, they are also talking about a tax for carbon. This tax should be applied to all gasolines, all these, you know, carbon products. And then the money collected by the state should be given back to the society. It's not another tax. It's just to reduce the gasoline consumption. Well, the Spanish government is planning to ban a sale of gasoline by 2040. California wants to be 100% renewable by 2045. And Brussels has made compulsory by 2050 we have to have a totally carbon neutral Europe. That's fantastic. So I know Europe is leading the efforts in that sense, and let's hope it can be progressing. Well, in Spain, we organize with the University in Barcelona every year these symposiums where we discuss, like today, climate change. But listen what this Nobel Prize says. Richard Schrock, we'll have to go to another planet. Sounds terrible, isn't it? And the same thing was said by James Green, director of NASA. He said a couple of years ago, well, 5 years ago, that we have to be prepared. Go living in Mars. To me, this sounds terrible. I wouldn't like to go to Mars. because I couldn't plant the vines. It would be terrible. Can you imagine a world without wine? Very depressing. Well, I love Greta Thunberg. I think she's doing for the young people a fantastic job. And when in Spain some journalist writes, you know, silly things about her, I write back because I think she has to be respected. She's doing such a wonderful job. So what can we do to help to prevent warming? You can have PVs in your houses, photovoltaic panels, electric cars, reduced beef, carbon neutral buildings, you know, more insulation in the buildings, more also PVs for the heating and the cooling in the summer can be made with renewable energies, less plastic, and especially influence others. That's what I'm doing now and I try to do all the time, influence other people, especially the wine people if I can. That's why we came this year with together with the Jackson family in California. We got together and we have created this group which is called International Wineries for Climate Action since October. And now we are already getting companies, at least 10, that, you know, they like to join us. But you see, to enter in this group, you have to have the calculation of the carbon footprint, including the three scopes, and it has to be audited. You have to reduce by 25% in the past 10 years, a minimum of 20% by produce of the energy by renewable energies, and you have a mid-long strategy, 50% in 2030, 80% in 2045. So that's, you know, the only thing I can do, try to influence others, try to get more people to enter. And you know, it's amazing. You have heard, I'm sure, in the past that there are some wineries in the world when they advertise or they go on PR, they say, well, we are carbon neutral. I'm sure you read that sometimes. Well, I got a list of 10 of these companies, so we wrote them a letter after we made these international wineries. We wrote them a letter and I said, well, this is fantastic what you are doing. Would you like to join us? Like to join our group and, you know, have this, which is very seriously and everything? No answer. So you will have to be prepared in the future to separate marketing from reality, okay? And back the companies that are making an effort really to reduce emissions. Well, thank you very much, my friends. I hope it hasn't been too long.
Hi, thank you for the conference. That was very interesting. And congratulations as well. You guys are doing a lot for climate change. There's the one slide that really got to me and I'm trying to understand. You're talking about like discouraging organic viticulture, which for me is something that I have never heard before. And knowing that a lot of the wines that are sold and that are marketed in a lot of the markets are very, very industrial wines. I find it strange and just odd to discourage the consumption or the practice of organic viticulture. And I'm trying to understand as well, maybe a second question, what you're comparing organic to traditional viticulture, what you mean by traditional.
Okay, fine.
Thank you.
Fine. Well, you know, somehow, yes, somehow what I'm trying to do, I'm trying to mobilize, you know, politicians and governments to change organic viticulture. I think the concept of organic viticulture is great, but they have to change it. We cannot continue to use copper. I make organic wines, don't take me wrong. Make organic wines in Spain, in Chile. Organic wines use copper. I don't like copper because we all know that copper is toxic. So this has to be changed. And we are, you know, mobilizing in Europe for Brussels to change this. The problem is that Brussels doesn't make change quickly because they want all Europeans Italy, France, Germany to agree. That's one problem. Second problem is the emissions. More treatments, it means more carbon emissions. Well, this is no good. In the future, if we have more tractors, electric tractors, then it's a... But I got some news for you, some good news for you. Countries like Chile, California, in the summer, it doesn't rain. It doesn't rain. So they don't have to treat against mildew. At least I know the case in Chile. In Chile, we don't have rain in the summer, so we don't have mildew, right? Which means we don't have to use the copper. These are the good news for you, okay? Chilean organic, this is without copper. And the sulfur is only 3 or 4 times in the summer you spray with sulfur, that's it. So let's hope, you know, we have a different, schema for organic wines in the future. And yeah, the other products probably is all right. If you buy organic salads, organic tomatoes, organic fruit, this is okay. I'm just talking about viticulture.
Thank you.
One of the solutions, Mr. Torres, to your other direction, here we go. one of the solutions you've identified is the use of glass containers that may be reused. Unfortunately, in Canada, we don't have filling stations for Masla Plana and Viña Esmeralda. We'd like that, I think. So what would need to be done in the industry to see that happen, whether it's in the Canadian marketplace or elsewhere in the world where people are drinking wine?
Mm-hmm. Well, as I said before, this idea of reutilizing bottles instead of recycling bottles could be used only for the entry-level wines, which means probably 80% of the market. Wines like Masla Plana, Mouton Rochelle, whatever, probably they will continue to use, you know, their special, very special bottles. So for these wines, this could be done and should be easy, but you should have legislation. Governments in Europe and in Canada should legislate to have, for these wines, maybe one or two types of a Bordelais bottle or Burgundy bottle, right? So that, you know, you wouldn't have to separate or classify 100 different types. So every country or every continent should have one type of Bordelais or two Burgundians, maybe two Alsace, and that should be it. I remember in the 1960s when I arrived to the company, we were doing that. We had a washing machine, I remember that. We washed the bottles, we selected them. It was terrible, you know. Some bottles arrived with oil inside, and it was really difficult. But today in Spain, there are companies, we are doing already in Barcelona a test with Capravo, it's a large supermarket. We're doing a test with Viñasol, and it has a hanger saying this bottle is going to be reutilized. Sales are up by 20%. Which means, you know, maybe this is the way for the future.
I have a mic. You're obviously doing some amazing things, and I'm just wondering, as a company that still, I assume, pursues growth and profitability, how you reconcile the natural tension between sustainability and this growth and the profitability, making, you know, taking over more land for more vineyards and so on. Do you have a ratio? Do you have a mission statement that is calculated or something that you measure in every decision that you make moving forward? Because it's remarkable what you're doing, but we also know that you're a major player on this earth in terms of business.
Could you repeat it, please? I didn't get exactly the question.
I'm just wondering what your mission statement in terms of reconciling the tension between growth, profitability, and responsibility with the planet.
Okay, fine. Right, thank you, I got it. Well, if you're talking about profitability, forget it. It doesn't work. When we decided in our company in 2008 that we're going to try to mitigate the effects of climate change, I proposed to the board to invest every year 11% of the profit. 11%. And this has been done accordingly. When my son joined the company in 6 years ago, I gave him a letter saying, you compromise also, we'll continue with this. We will continue to invest 11%. And he has accepted. So we continue, you see. 11% of the profit, right? So that's how we were. But then, of course, you know, if we were in the stock market, we couldn't do it, because probably the shareholders will tell us, but what do you do? Huh? What is worth? They want to see the money, no? So that's why I think family-owned companies are much better for that.
And just in terms, if I can ask a second question to follow up, when you move your vineyard sites to higher altitudes and different locations based on climate change, et cetera, what are you doing with the existing or the current vineyards in terms of mm-hmm. renewable land use?
Right. Well, you know, it's like a rotation. When you move, say, a grape like, you know, Riesling to the higher land, because you need the acidity, okay, then, you know, this Riesling in the plain is going to be replaced by maybe a Carignana, right? It's a rotation.
Thank you.
Okay. I have a question. So I saw that you're buying land to actually replant trees, but are you thinking of reintroducing trees and ground covers in the vineyards that you're right now exploiting?
Mm-hmm. No, in the vineyards, no, we are not thinking of planting trees. Viticulture has to be separated. You have some trees in the border. The trees we are planting is all in Patagonia. And the idea we have started, we want to plant 200 hectares every year. That's what we can afford. And we hope to reach 2,000 hectares in 10 years. We are planting at this stage mostly pinus trees, ponderosa, which grows very fast. But then, right now, we had a discussion this past week. We're going to combine this with some of the native trees, native forests, right? It's going to be a combination of both, right? But in the vineyards, no. In the vineyards, I wouldn't like to have trees around because the roots will affect the vines.